Brilliant speech, I call it talk or speech, whatever, but you spoke very well, and to your best abilities you defended Gulen and his movement. But if he has been, if he is a paragon of virtues, and if he has established so many institutions which have embedded into Turkish society, why he has been abroad, why he has been self-exiled actually for so many years, for decades? First question. And the second question is that there were talks that, there were news in the press that perhaps the Turkish president Erdogan had bought oil from ISIS. Is that true? Does the Turkish establishment have some sort of relationship, hidden relationship with the ISIS? And the third question concerns you. You have been so fiercely critical of the Erdogan government and his establishment. Do you fear that once you go back, perhaps you will also be put behind the bars and you cannot speak the way you spoke here with so much confidence and fearlessly and frankly? Thank you.
Yes.
During your presentation, you said that out of this fear factor, this Gulen movement is suppressed by the present ruler. Then what's your observation that who are really behind this coup and what are the root causes, first? Second, do you think that this will affect the Turkey's future or prospective membership in EU? Thank you.
A reporter from PTI News Agency. I had 2-3 questions. It is true that the local civilians supported the military forces over there. That's why this coup was declared as unsuccessful. And after the coup attempt was neutralized by the security forces with the collaboration with the local people, I am saying inverted comma, there were reports that almost 1,000 detractors, I mean those who were supporting the coup, those have been put behind the bars. So what fate they are going to face? And my third question is that you said that your university has been complete in lockdown position. So
more than 20 universities, not only my university.
Okay, okay.
More than 20 universities.
Okay,
more than 5,000 educational institutions.
So only the educational institutions are there who are facing the brunt, or some there are institutions?
Every institution which is in state understanding is linked with Gulen. I am not saying that these are the Gulen institution. My employment contract nowhere says it is the Gulen institutions. In state imagination, it is being perceived as a Gulen institutions. All of them. Mm-hmm. Should I take up this first set of questions?
Excuse me, sir.
Let him answer these and then you can come back to the second set of questions. Mm-hmm.
Well, I wish that I should have really defended Gulen movement, which is at the moment that is not my job here actually. But I do believe is that in any kind of the lecture and discussion between a civil society and a state, I would certainly stand by the civil society movement than against the state. That's my position actually. And given my position, because I always believe the democracy is not possible without any critical discourse of the state. And states, invariably, wherever, would certainly not pray for any kind of democratic space. A state would like to pray for. You know, given these situations, there is a possibility that my lecture actually looked upon, or maybe conceived, that I am defending as a Gulen movement, actually. But probably I am not, you know. All I am saying is that is a vibrant, faith-based civil society movement. You know, it has expanded the zone of democracy, actually. And state is crashing. Since the state is crashing, state is becoming much more illiberal and much more undemocratic and much more authoritarian. And that's precisely the reasons that I will pray for any civil society and strengthen of civil society for the development of democracy in any society. That's my intake. Now, as far as the question is that, why exile? the Gulen movement, the Gulen, why the Gulen is leaving America. I really wish that the Muslim society globally would have actually afforded a space for a critical scholars to live. Fazlur Rahman died in Chicago from Pakistan, one of the remarkable Islamic scholars. Where is the space? But that's exactly what I'm saying is that. Where is the space for a Muslim critical thinker to live in their own society? All Muslim critical thinkers live outside their own Muslim society. So it is a paradoxical. And it is really very sad that wherever the Muslim society is and the kind of the state that we're having, that does not allow, you know, for a Muslims with a critical thinker of state having a different kind of the visions to live in their own society. As a result, what you find, the large number of the Muslim critical thinkers from the Saudi Arabia, from Iraq, from Pakistan, from Bangladesh, from, they all live abroad actually, you know. It is also unfortunate that even M.F. Hussain has to leave and live in Qatar actually. You know, it's really unfortunate that also happened in India, in fact. So that's the condition. Yes, Gulen leave by 1998, both on the ground, and that time, you know, I mean, there was a military coup. He was harassed actually, so he went for the medical purpose, and as well as probably the space that actually allow him to explore his own ideas, to work his own ideas, which America and Europe actually give that. Noam Chomsky can actually survive in America by calling the United States as a terrorist state. Which Muslim society would you give you that kind of freedom? Give me. And that's the exactly reason where the critical thinkers actually move. You know, as far as the Erdogan linkage with the ISIS, or for example, linkage with the illegal oil and the sale, yes, it is already very much in the news. Linkage is there. And the journalist who actually cover the news, Turkey has the dubious distinction of arresting the largest number of journalists in the world. And the journalist who covered with the photograph that the trucks totally load of the Turks, Turkey's arms going to the ISIS, has been in jail, released recently, but he's moving abroad now. And the state actually cracked down, not on the ground of an illegality, but saying that you are basically exposing the classified decision of the state. You are not supposed to. What journalists are supposed to do then? Our journalists are supposed to do not to expose the state? The second instance is that there's a very radical communist left newspaper called Taraf in Turkey, actually. The Taraf actually came out in 2012, you know, with the open documents, releasing the documents in the newspaper, ki how a committee and how, for example, the document was signed between the military, President Gul, Prime Minister Erdogan, to finish off this Hijmat movement in 2004. And they were basically pressurizing, and that Taraf leader was also, that Taraf journalist was also arrested for exposing the classified document, or what is called state secrets. Why did you expose this? So that is the situation. It's very much in the public domain, actually. As far as myself going to Turkey is that I have written almost 12 to 15 op-ed articles against the government while I was in basically Turkey. The newspaper was certainly shut down now. The Today's Zaman and this and that. Now the university is shut down. I am looking for a job. If you can offer me a job, I'll be very happy. I am here, in fact. No, it has been shut down. I am looking. This is my open appeal to all of you. Provide me a job. I am looking for a job, actually, as of now. And and as far as the EU, certainly the Turkish chances for the EU membership has actually radically gone down. If Turkey is planning to revive the death penalty, Turkey can't become the member of the UN. You know, it's absolutely. If the PKK leader, for example, Gulen, what is his name, is he's in jail, Abdullah Öcalan, if he's in jail and he's surviving because the Turkey has abolished the death penalty in 2002 while moving towards the European Union. Now the Turkey is to want to revive, you know, the death penalty, and with this authoritarianism, where there's no rule of law, where there's completely crackdown onto the oppositional newspaper and other kinds of, the jail is following. I mean, situation is like this, that the state has to release more than 38,000, you know, 38,000 criminals in order to accommodate Gulen followers. I mean, that is the situation, and that has become official. You know, so I think it has a very, doesn't have any chance, you know. As far as the people support at the time of the NT, I think there are two versions. One version is that, which I believe, that this people's mobilization against the army was very much organized. It was not spontaneous. Check it. Why I'm saying is this, at 10:30 the army took place. At 11 o'clock, every Turkish mosque was full of azan and calling the people to come on the street. That Erdogan is in Tanger actually. So there was, mosque was used as an instrument of mobilization, and every half an hour azan was taking place in every districts and every parts of Turkey actually. You know, so therefore I'm saying is that whether these peoples who are supposed to do this was spontaneous and organized, it's much more organized, and that shall we point out that the state element's involvement in organizing the AKP, in organizing the mosque, Erdogan coming of the hotels, and no, the Erdogan is on the record, that his two bodyguard has been killed. The fact is that both the bodyguards are alive. And he gave the interview on international CNN channel. So there is a much dot. I'm not buying state has done. But all I'm saying is that circumstantial evidence actually points out that the involvement of the states in creating this kind of the crisis. After all, none of the ministers was killed in this operation. None of the AKP high official was arrested. None of the army chief was actually, what kind of military coup is this? I really don't understand. You know, what kind of this? So I really, it has not affected the state functionaries in any way. You know, and that's the larger questions in fact, you know. I don't take position because I don't have the evidence. The international community, a good section of the international community is saying state manage. But how can I say when I really do not have that evidence where the Erdogan has instructed and planned and executed, okay, let's do this way. All I'm saying is this, that the circumstantial evidence actually suggests and points out, and therefore there should be the international commission as demanded by Fatehullah Gulen to find out who are the elements and how it has been done. But I am pretty sure that this government will certainly refuse it. It will forget about international. It will not have even the domestic judicial investigation. Forget about any independent international commission as such. Yes.
So why do you say that this movement is taking place of converting into a global movement?
Yes.
On what basis you are saying?
It is a becoming, for example, one of the remarkable Islamic movement who is offering education, dialogue, tolerance, brotherhoods. You know, it has a presence in more than 150 countries.
Such as?
Huh? Such as America, such as in Europe, yeah, such as in Australia, such as in India, such as in Pakistan, such as in Africa, such as in the Central Asia. Everywhere. It's a remarkable movement.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I wanted to ask that I think in August, Erdogan is meeting Putin also, or I think there was a conversation that he had with him. So what do you see him doing next and him legitimizing his stance apart from all the, apart from, you know, whatever is happening with the institutions and everything? What else will his moves be to further... you know, make his stance more stronger in the country after such an unsuccessful coup has happened.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Good evening, sir. Sir, my understanding of the Gulen movement before I came to this lecture was zero. And it was very informative. And I just have one questioning recurring in my mind over and over. In the time when something like Islamic movement, associating Islamic movement with secular scientific education is something I cannot imagine. So in this, in today's era, how does something like Gulen movement emerge and it's spreading, it's becoming global, and then we have something like ISIS and Taliban and all of the other radical Islamic movements. You know, how does the two of them coexist together? It's something beyond my understanding.
Yes. There is the 7 organizations in India where the Gulen, which is related to the Gulen movement, and the Turkish government wants to close their activities in India. Mm. He has meeting, I think he had meeting with the, recently he had meeting with the government officials. Mm. So what do you think about that? What is going on?
So before this coup happened, there was a, you know, Turkish government wanted to develop some mall or something over there in the capital and the Times Square, something like that, and the people opposed it because they wanted to, they used to use it in the traditional way. So there was a lot of opposition to that, and that government held back that decision to develop that some area over there. So that is the thing. So who are the people who opposed so openly to the government?
What is that?
But that's some, there was some devil.
Park in Istanbul.
Oh, that's a Gezi movement.
Okay.
That's long ago.
No, who are the people behind that movement? Because, you know, all the people, as you said, supporting the president. And another question I wanted to ask is that, you know, what is the reaction of the American State Department? The President Erdogan openly not accused the Gulen, but he says that CIA and the American government is behind this coup to overthrow me. So what is the State Department's reaction to this? I have not heard anything about that because this is openly accusation by the head of the one state to the another state.
Yes.
This Turkey, it seems to be a very, 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 very difficult to understand that how they are moving now towards Russia, or I mean their relation with ISIS. This is a very confusing state at the moment, and I do not understand in which direction it will go, because if they are opposing Gulen, that means they are opposing, in fact, they are accusing America. And America, it's very, very difficult to understand as to in which direction Turkey will go now.
Okay.
Sir, do you think in India, Gulen movement has some perspective, like it is expanding in India?
Should I take up these questions? This whole questions of the meeting between the Erdogan and the Putin and the other is a larger context, actually. One context is that by 2014, some of the major public policies which was connected with the AKP start falling down, actually. Like, for example, it's zero neighbor policies. The AKP was credited for its zero neighbor policy. So it executed visa-free with Syria, with Iran, with everybody. By 2014, Turkey does not have the ambassador in Egypt. Turkey does not have the ambassador in Israel. Turkey does not have ambassador in Israel, in Syria, actually. Turkey does not have the ambassadors in Libya, actually. And therefore, for example, is that it's created, the perception was emerging that Turkey's foreign policy is becoming extremely problematic, and Turkey is increasingly becoming isolated in the world affairs, in fact. It was in that context that relationship with Israel was already very bad, actually. It was in this context that, for example, the Russian warplane, or for example, was shot down. Now, you will be surprised to know that when it was shot down, then that time, the president and Davutoglu and the prime ministers and everybody takes a very heroic call that we have done it, because in the Turkish context, it is the Russia which is other of Turkey. So if you do anything against Russia, you become hero, actually. I mean, that is the kind of the Turkish nationalism. It is defined much more anti-Russia than actually any other things, actually, and everybody claims. Now today, the president and some of the new prime minister and officials are claiming The Russian missile was basically shot down by the Hizmet people, by the Gulen movement people. They were into the army. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. That is an official statement has actually come out. Erdogan also said in the Moscow, actually. In between, what was happening is that with the, because of the increasing terrorist incident and all, Turkey was losing lots of revenue on the tourist front, actually. Tourism is one of the major sources of revenue of Turkey's economy, in fact. And the three countries that supply the largest tourists is Russia, Germany, Israel, you know. As a result, the hotels and the tourist business and the others has actually went down. It is actually in this context, and because of the pressure generated by the AKP link with the businessman and the tourist lobby and the hotel lobby and the other, that Erdogan was forced to tender an unconditional apology to the Russian President Putin, actually. You know, that yes, we are extremely sorry, you know. And that's how, for example, the relationship have basically restored. Simultaneously, it also restored a relationship with Israel, you know, because the Erdogan was basically insisting that the Israeli government must compensate for the people who was killed by the Israeli in the Mavi Marwara case, actually. You know, and the Israeli government finally refused, and finally the Israeli government has come out with a remarkable formula. And the formula is very simple, that Israeli government will not pay a direct compensation to the families whose children was killed by the Israeli soldiers on the 8 ships, Mavi Marwara, but the Israeli government will pay money. No, the Israeli will pay money to the Israeli NGOs, and this Israeli NGOs will pay money to the families. So it is not the state. And Erdogan actually projected that it has won the game. Israel has actually accepted. So everything is actually fine. But that's how the diplomacy is. Because this whole people are very much this decline of tourism. So whether for example, mending relation with Russia, mending relation with this, mending with relation has this decline in the tourist industries. And that's how you actually seen that. But you are not the one that has posed this question, that as far as the Islamic movement appearing as a scientific movement as a kind of contradictions. Recently, just a week ago, I was sitting with one of the very senior IB officer in Delhi, and he wanted to know about the Gulen movement, and then he called me. He actually, at the end of our discussion, 1 hour discussion, he actually posed me this question, can Islamic movement be a scientific movement? Professor Alam, tell me. How can be the Islamic movement a progressive movement? How is it possible? I mean, this is where we came actually. You know, and that's a serious. And I think part of the reason is that because over the last 400 and 500 years, we have not seen any Islamic movement in empirical terms coming on a scientific scale, which we consider social, democratic, normal, offering the secular education, and therefore it's extremely hard to believe. But the second is that this movement is certainly to a large extent a scientific movement, whether you want to use scientific movement or not, but this movement certainly advances the very democratic vision of a good life. It gives freedom, it gives moderation, it believes in tolerance, it believes in dialogue, it believes in common brotherhoods, and it takes the very inclusive understanding of Islam, actually. You know, even I was not much aware when I started reading, it really takes a very inclusive understanding of Islam, actually, you know, to the extent, actually, that there is no community without prophet, actually. For large number of Muslims, Hindu will actually appear the polytheist, actually, but the Gulen will actually would believe that there is no community with a prophet, actually. You know, so he takes a very inclusive understanding, actually, you know. For Gulen, a Muslim is the one who believes in all prophets. Who not only believe in the Prophet Muhammad, which is otherwise a matter of faith, but who believes in all prophets. If you do not believe in all prophets, then you cease to be a Muslim, actually. You know? And that's a remarkable, very inclusive interpretation of Islam he actually takes. He takes these positions also is that, yes, God has created the nations and the communities. We compete for the sake of our grace, actually. That essentially means do good things, positive things, education, love, harmony, and compete ourselves, actually. And therefore, the Muslims should also develop a capacity to compete for doing a good work. That's it. But we don't have any empirical instances. Gulen movement actually created this kinds of structure globally actually. That his idea was this, if today the modernity has become a dominant structure, then Islam has to represent in that structure. That's it. He actually believed not only in Islam, but in which form the Islam should be represented. A far more important question is the representation of Islam. Should Islam be represented only in the context of the madarsas, whose certificate, and you may be very bright, doesn't hold any value into the marketplace actually. And therefore, the secular education is needed because this form of education has become much more hegemonic today actually. You know, and therefore you must open it. You know, so he took up the case very seriously, and in Turkey it has been succeeded because the state doesn't allow you Islamic education and the madarsa, so you can open yourself actually. That's how it is actually. As far as this closing down institution in, I mean, closing down institution in India with the Turkey government is asking, I am pretty sure that the Turkish government is mad, that the Indian government is not mad. I am sure on this issue. You know, it may be the Turkish, I mean, this is the first case we are witnessing that the Turkish Republic is trying to internationalize its own domestic problem. But this is your domestic problem. There is a large number of faith-based, large number of the Christian movement. Today the Britain will come and say, you know, close down all the convent schools. Tomorrow the American Protestant says, no, close down all the convent and the other kinds of schools. Who will listen? I mean, forget about India. The Central Asian Republic has rejected the Erdogan advice. They have not closed down their own schools because they are the cream schools actually. Forget about India actually. Even the Pakistan has rebuffed Turkey, which is a very close ally of Turkey in fact. That the government has not even succeeded in Pakistan. Gulen movement doesn't have a very strong presence one and two through. And we badly need a Gulen movement. Because we badly need education among the Indian Muslims. Indian Muslim situation is to a large extent parallel to the Turkish Muslim at one point of time, where the parents would not send. I mean, look at the situation today. Jamia Millia and Aligarh Muslim University is becoming overtly crowded. It is becoming overtly crowded. There is not much. And every family would like for a Muslim university where you send your own children, actually. Why the Muslim community cannot have a faith in other educational institutions? Why the Muslim community cannot understand education as a neutral educational space? You know, we need these kinds of the movement, actually, you know, so that the Muslim community can be educated, can become much more democratic, can become much more, I mean, if you do not have educational infrastructure, let us see the situation that Indian Muslims want to live under a democratic and secular republic. Very good. I also want to live under a democratic and secular republic. But what it is, what role as a Muslim I play in enhancing and expanding this democratic republic of India? I don't play any role. I don't create any modern educational institution. I do not participate in any democratic struggle. But I cherish the vision that I want a democratic and secular India so that I could maintain my religious identity. That's it. So then the democracy actually emerged as a remarkable instrumental values in a Muslim society. And therefore, in Turkey, whatever the experiences that you say between 2002 and 2010, democracy remains an instrumental value. And democracy is actually confined to basically, it begins and ends with election, that's all. Election kara dijiye, ho gaya aapka democracy, khatam, you know. So at one point of time, a state experimented with democracy. When it doesn't need, it also conscripted democracy actually. Middle Eastern history is remarkable history of the expansion and conscription of the stages of democracy. Whenever the state wants, it gives you democracy. Whenever it wants, it takes it back actually. That's how the history of the Middle East, you know. So, and this is possible where the people's participation in democracy is extremely weak. For the first time, the people become much more visibly on the democratic front only in the context of the Arab Spring. Historically, the national movement and the freedom movement in the Arab world is totally devoid of any kind of the mass participation, unlike in India. And since the Indian freedom struggle was full of the mass participation, you have a very powerful democratic institution which is growing day by day. So that's not the case in the case. Yes, as far as this question about the park and all, it is related with a very powerful, the environmental and the Gezi movement actually, that was there for last 2 and 3 years. Erdogan called that park issue and as a terrorist movement actually, and crushed them. That was the remarkable student youth-based environmental movement actually. Erdogan wanted to construct mosque there. They wanted to save this park, that please do not have a mosque so that everybody can come with a girlfriend and the boyfriend and enjoy. Absolutely, mosque mein ho jaga to both kam log aa payenge na. So it was a remarkable youth romanticism, you know. Erdogan call it as a terrorist outfit and crush it and even accuse the youth who was killed as a terrorist one. Today, Turkey, if you have any dissenting voice, state will dub it as a terrorist expression. That's how the situation has reached in a Turkey, in fact. As far as the role of the United States is concerned, I am pretty sure large number of the Muslim rulers actually enjoy the legitimacy of Islam and anti-West, and they survive in the power. Erdogan is also doing West, and the problematic is that most of the Muslim societies actually thrive on the conspiracy. They do not look in the internal problems, they always blame the others. Since given the Gulen locations in America, it becomes much more convenient for Erdogan to say, look, Gulen is there, America is there, and Erdogan and Turkey is emerging very powerful. So powerful that the West would not like to see the emergence of any powerful Muslim nation. And the history of America is that it always acts against any emergence of the Muslim powerful nation. What is the whole idea of this whole idea of the powerful Muslim nation? Does this powerful Muslim nation believe in the rule of law? Does this Muslim, the whole idea of the great Muslim personality and Muslim power believe in the independence of judiciary, in the freedom of expression, in the rule of law, in the separation of power, in the creation of the human resources, in the advancement of scientific development, in the creation of technology? On what basis you can become so powerful? You can only become powerful precisely because of the remarkable anti-Western rhetoric all the time. Khomeini symbolized at one point of time, Nasserism symbolized at one point of time, Erdogan is symbolizing another point of time. As a result, what's happening today, I'm afraid, and I'm taking on this official, that today there is not much difference between the Erdogan rhetoric of anti-West and ISIS rhetoric of anti-West. The difference is there, and if it's a difference of much more degree, and I'm really afraid that the Erdogan is actually becoming the source of radicalism for a large number of the Muslims actually. He is being held. And that's the area where we are extremely concerned, in fact, in the whole issue of this greatness, in fact, you know. And therefore, the U.S. would not like to extradite Gulen, not at all. Because the U.S. is the country that believes in the rule of law, the separation of power. It is not the case that Erdogan believes. Erdogan fundamentally and personally believes that the politics is all about give and take. I give you this person, you give me this person. That's it. I have given you in the past, whatever the list you gave me, I am also asking you, give me this person, why are you not giving me actually? But politics is not about give and take. For certain nation, politics also involves the whole question of the values. You know, you submit evidence, US will examine, there is a judge, there is a separation of power. And the second is that US badly need the moderate voice of Islam, the moderate form of Islam vis-a-vis the radical perception of Islam. So for this reason, I don't think that, and what Turkey? Turkey is not, I mean, it is not the United States who is dependent on Turkey. For all practical purpose, it is a Turkey who is dependent on the United States. Economic aids, technology, you are a member of NATO. The day the United States will decide you will be out of NATO, is as simple as that, you will lose the privilege. What the asymmetry between Turkey and the US is very high. But US and the Europe has become accustomed to tolerate this kind of the anti-West rhetoric, and they have been listening over the last 50 years. This is nothing new for them actually. You know, this is nothing new for them actually, you know. So that's absolutely fine, it will come and it will go actually, you know. As far as the Gulen movement in India, I think I've already mentioned that they, yes, they have some presence and they have run some schools and colleges and are doing a wonderful job, yes. उनका भविष्य क्या जेल में है और क्या जेल में जो भविष्य जेल में होता है वही होगा टेररिज्म के चार्जेस एंड सिडिएशन क्या टेररिज्म दे आर ट्रेटर्स that the state has gone to the extent of creating a cemetery for territors. You know, those who die, they will not be even be offering the janaja namaz. Territor wahan ek jagah bana diya, wahan jaiye aap. So they are going to be the much, much worse life actually.
Territors have their own kabristan.
Absolutely, that's what I'm saying is that the government has marked a separate. You know, so this state has gone to a different situation.
Hello, sir. Unlike the previous military coups, this one wasn't fully supported by the military. Only a part of the military was taking part in this coup, which is very like a matter of speculation, you know, why not the entire military, which adds on to your own argument, which says it may or may not have been, you know, state influenced. Now my question is that if the coup is constitutional, because the constitution of Turkey does allow for a coup, if it's secular in nature, to protect the secular nature of Turkey or the current stance of Turkey, then how are these guys facing, how are these guys in jail, 1,000 people in jail? And even if they are in jail on the grounds of sedition, how is it that they are, this has been slammed on them without any inquiry? Like you said, there was no domestic or international inquiry. So, I mean, how it doesn't connect, that's my question.
So that's what I'm saying, is that you should ask this question to Erdogan. Not actually.
But it, at the end of the day, is a democracy, right? So it is.
Absolutely, this is not a democracy, actually. That's exactly what I'm saying, is that they have not been charged, actually. They have been only charged because in the state perception, they are saying is that they are linked with Gulen. So if you're linked with Gulen, you will be in jail, actually. I mean, that is the course that is actually taking place. I mean, you are talking about the 1,000 of these military officers. What is the role of the teaching community? Large number of them in jail. Judiciary, bureaucrats, accountants, police officers, they did not participate into the military coup, but they are also in jail, you know. So I think is that the state is essentially in the business of creating a perception that the Gulen movement is a terrorist movement, is basically anti-nationalist, and we have to crush it, and we have to crush it for exactly as ever. You know, only by virtue of elimination, Gulen Erdogan believe that he can be secure. You know, he can be...
Is there a people's movement against...
As of now, there is a not.
Action. Because the Gulen movement was essentially...
No, that exactly I'm saying. As of now, there is a no people's movement, that there is a, as of now, the national consensus. All the opposition parties are with the government in branding Gulen movement, actually, a civil social movement, actually, as an anti-national movement, you know, because they're the part and the parcel of the military coup without any kind of the evidences, in fact. And they would not like to go against any kind of the state narratives, you know. So you are absolutely right that there has to be some charges and the other things, but there's no rule of law as of now, actually. You know, I have never... Because I was in Turkey in 2015, I could see the government took over Zaman newspaper before 1 week of election. And I said, ki, how is this happen? A newspaper that has circulation of 1 million, it take over complete buildings in before 1 week of elections. It is not afraid of elections also. You know, so we are dealing with that kind of the state. So you have to really understand what is this nature of the state and from where it has that kind of the capacity. And to that, we really need to go to the historical tradition of the state. If you look at from that point of view, then what's happening in Turkey as of now, it may be abnormal from my point of view and your point of view, but from the Middle Eastern point of view, it is perfectly normal. You know, that is the situation.
Sir.
Yes.
So you spoken about the combining the religious education with the science and the religious education. But how far you will go? Because the science is now approach of inventing a quantum particle, the particle which has become a reason to become a creation in the world. So now, if you science has gone on that, and if you question the creation, the idea of the creation, so if religion have a different idea of creation, the science has a different idea of creation. So how far you will go combining these two educational strengths?
Well, I do not have much idea upon your question, and I do not believe is that the Gulen is providing religious education in their own schools and the colleges. All he's trying to say is that he's trying to give a moral and ethical understanding of religion, that be a good human being, and when you experiment the science and acquire a scientific point of view, do not make a science an ideological entity, actually. Treat science as a science. Don't make science an ideological. And therefore, there should be moral and ethical understanding of the science too, actually. You know, his conception is that like, for example, the Western education produced a very good doctor, actually, you know. But that not necessarily the doctor is also the human doctor. The doctor is also very much involved in only minting money and this and that. How to create or how to combine the whole idea of professionalism and the whole idea of humanism. The whole idea of professionalism actually require an application of secular education, and whole idea of humanism require the application of moral and ethical understanding of religion. That's how they would like to.
One last question from Dr. Khan.
Sir, how do you see after this coup, Erdogan has come to power taking some support from Kurdish parliamentarians also. So how is he going to face this Kurdish question of redrawing the map? Will Erdogan will be party to this particular recreating a map for Kurdish people?
I don't think that, for example, I mean, as of now, Erdogan does not enjoy much support among the Kurdish sections, actually. It enjoyed support of the Kurdish section from 2005 to 2010, when it gave lots of cultural autonomy, linguistic autonomy to the Kurdish, and AKP won the large number of seats from the Kurdish area, and that's how Erdogan sat. Since it broke the peace, bombarded the Kurdish cities, it has actually lost, actually, in fact. And probably the AKP would not be in a position to guarantee any kind of the autonomy to that. He actually believes in any kind of authoritarian solution, in fact. And therefore, in the coming days, the conflict between the Kurdish and the Turkish is likely to increase much more. So that's going to happen, actually.
Thank you so much for your questions. Thank you, sir, for being so patient and responding to all of them. I would now like to invite Chairman of ORF Mumbai, Mr. Sudhindra Kulkarni, to give his closing remarks.